As you know, my name is Kat Dunn, and I have the best job in the world. Some people call it a mixologist, a molecular mixologist, a bar chef, a liquid chef, a craft cocktail specialist, a cocktail artist, or even coctologist. Seriously? I'm a bartender. I don't get offended when you call me any of those names, except coctologist. But what I really do is tend bar, tend to people, tend to the thirsty, tend to needs. I'm a bartender, and I have the best job in the world. Why do I have the best job in the world? Because I have the bounty of the Hudson Valley at my fingertips. Why do I have the best job in the world? Because I'm able to tend to people and their needs. There's an interaction between me and the customer, an understanding of what they want sometimes when they don't know. Why do I have the best job in the world? Because I help break down people's inhibitions to laugh and socialize and get to know others. And these are some of the keys to happiness. Why do I have the best job in the world? Because I'm a little bit of a cocktail nerd. So coming to the place where the word cocktail was first defined in print seems like kismet. There's no real theory on how exactly the cocktail became the cocktail. One thought is from a tavern in Lewiston, New York. Hustler's Tavern was the only building left unscathed when the British invaded. It was said that the British officers had had one too many good nights enjoying a cocktail that owner Catherine Hustler invented when she stirred a gin mixture with the tail feather of a stuffed cock. Miss Kitty, as she was called, said, "It warms both a body and soul and is fit to be put in a vessel of diamonds." Kitty Hustler, is there a better name than that? If you're looking for a name other than bartender, that's the one to call me. It could also be a cocktail that could be a metaphor for the rooster heralding dawn, as it originally was a morning beverage. Spirits drank to warm you before you went out onto the farm. What is irrefutable is that the first definition in print of the word cocktail was right here in Hudson, New York. I know, right? It was in 1806, and the editor of the local paper, the Columbian Balance and Repository, was answering a reader when asked what he meant when he referenced a cocktail in regard to a politician. The editor said, "It's a stimulating liquor comprised of spirits, water, bitters, and ice. It's an excellent electioneering potion inasmuch as it renders the heart stout and bold at the same time that it fuddles the head." The technical definition is still the same today, although the term cocktail has really evolved into any mixed alcoholic beverage. But the part about it rendering the heart stout and bold at the same time fuddling the head is the same today as it was in 1806. We can talk about drinking through the ages because drinking's not going away. It's been here since the beginning of time. It was written about in the book of Genesis. It's lasted through the noble experiments of prohibition. It'll go on into the foreseeable future. In the interest of time, I know everyone wants a drink. I won't start at the beginning of time. Instead, I'll start just about the time that ice became readily available. It was in the 1820s, and Frederick Tudor of Boston started harvesting lake ice and shipping it to warmer port cities. He created a demand for ice. Prior to this, there really hadn't been much demand for it. So then it became a little bit easier and wider spread with the railroad system being able to go to non-port system cities. And then finally, in 1851, the creation of the first ice machine. This was still a wealthy man's luxury. In the 1860s, Frederick Tudor's boats, when they were coming back from their ice running missions, brought back citrus from the tropics, which changed the cocktail game forever. We can then go forward to Prohibition. Everyone's heard stories of rum runners and bathtub gin and speakeasies. I heard these stories from my grandfather, Lefty. How apropos. He actually helped his dad as a bootlegger in Boston, Massachusetts. Here's to you, Pa. Barkeeps had really limited access to good booze, so they used sweeteners and juices and other things to really hide the flavor of the rot gut spirits. People didn't stop drinking, they just hid it. Actually, in 1925, 5 years after Prohibition started, the average American over the age of 14 drank 32.2 gallons of alcohol per year. For the two of you out there trying to do the math, that comes out to be about 7 drinks every day of the year. We can fast forward to the 60s and 80s, and this was really an interesting and weird kind of time. Sweet cocktails ruled this post-World War II America. They saved time and they saved money. Drinks like the Harvey Wallbanger and the Pink Flamingo, the Velvet Peanut, and who could forget the Slow Comfortable Screw. The 70s started, and it really became an opportunity for women to start frequenting fern bars. No longer was it really a dark, dim place where men sat around and smoked and drank booze, but a watering hole that was decorated with greenery and wood paneling, like the Regal Beagle from Three's Company, where Chrissy Snow and Janet Wood would feel comfortable going with Jack Tripper. But the 70s and 80s were really decades of excess. These were lean times for cocktails. Drinks were still drunk, but in a much less ritualized, much less habitual manner. It was more the method of mixing, the flipping, the tossing, the flair that was as important as the drink itself. Anyone here who will admit to watching Tom Cruise's antics in the movie Cocktail can attest to this. But milk drinks at this point, the White Russian, the Golden Cadillac, these were really what prevailed during this time. I mean, honestly, maybe it had a little bit to do with the proliferation of drugs that was going on at that time, and it kind of calmed the tummy. There's got to be a reason John Lennon exclusively drank Brandy Alexander's for his 18-month lost weekend. I wasn't there. I don't know. I'm just saying. But it brings us to now, to the present. Farm to glass, garden to glass. Or what some people call it, ground to glass. I prefer ground to glass because it takes into account locality and things that aren't just found out on the farm, but in your backyard or in your woods, like sumac or pine or berries. Really, what we're talking about is a moment of which we talk about farm to table all the time. Thank you, Alice and Catherine and the others for bringing this up, but why aren't we having the conversation about ground to glass? If you're concerned about what you're putting in your body, and you try not to eat genetically modified foods, or you go to the farmer's market to figure out what to put on your family's dinner for that night, why then do you go into the bar and order a rum and coke? Instead, look at that carrot from the garden and think, what an amazing, sweet and earthy, restorative cocktail that could be. Or look at that peach and think, Lord, imagine what it would taste like if it was sweet and juicy like freshly picked peach. We can practice detoxing while putting antioxidants, vitamins, and minerals in our body at the same time as a little bit of bad with some booze, which we'll call retoxing. This combination of detox and retox kind of balances things out, in my mind at least. You know, there's studies that are done that moderate drinkers live longer than abstainers. Hell, heavy drinkers live longer than teetotalers. But the question is why? Is it the quintessential thought of going home after work and having a cocktail to de-stress? We all know stress is a killer. Or it could be the social aspect. Drinking in moderation helps develop and nurture relationships that keep us alive. We are social primates. Alcohol is just a delightful lubricant to help erase some of those interpersonal anxieties. I'm by no means saying that no bad can come from over-imbibing, nor am I saying that all the health benefits come from the bottle, but they come from the people. Those lovely conversations that are held over a cocktail or three. I can sit here and I can talk about taking local ingredients and tending to your friends and looking out for them by feeding them locally foraged things, but what we're really talking about is hospitality. And with hospitality, I have to ask, is it in your DNA or is it learned? I know for me, I grew up watching my mom throw cocktail parties, and it was never anything super elaborate. It was usually something kind of disgusting in a Jell-O mold or some chips and onion dip. But the food wasn't the point. It was the bringing together of people, the convivial atmosphere, the fun. And she would usher me off to bed right away because she notoriously stressed before these events. So when you watch this, Mom, sorry. But I hated missing out on anything, and still do. So as soon as I could hear all the guests come, I would go to the top of the stairs and I would hide and I would listen to the party. And I would listen to the laughter get louder and louder. And I would listen as my mom would fill wine glasses or offer people more food. And I would listen as she really would take care of them. I would hear her tending to people. I would hear her taking care. I could envision it in my mind. It was almost like I was watching TV. It was at this moment that I realized how fulfilling it could be to tend to other people. I like the idea of combining this sense of hospitality with the idea of ground to glass. Recently, I created a cocktail, and it was a mountain rose infused vodka, cucumber, and egg white. And a friend of mine and a guest, the first time he tried it, he closed his eyes and he said, "Good Lord, it's like making out with my high school girlfriend all over again." And the fact that I could give that to him, that I could not only take care of his physical needs, but his emotional health as well. Giving him a memory that he had 30 years ago was really amazing. In the beginning, I talked about a deep connection I have with my guests. Oftentimes they come in and we talk about what they want, and sometimes they know and sometimes they don't, and we try and figure it out. That level of trust that they can come in and trust that I'm going to make them something from my bar that's going to suit them at that very moment is heartwarming. I had a guest come in, and he always used to order a bartender's choice. Sometimes I hit the nail on the head, and sometimes I totally missed. Listen, to be a baseball all-star, you only have to be good like one out of three times at bat. My stats were totally better than that. But this time I was stumped. I didn't know where to go. So instead of asking him what he liked, I asked him what he didn't like. This dude had to list 25 things off the top of his head that he didn't like, and not one of them had anything to do with booze. He said, "I don't like when I like a girl and she doesn't like me back. I don't like that people don't get dressed up to go to dinner anymore. I don't like that people don't read books anymore." Well, this list went on and on, and finally I kind of walked away mid-sentence, I admit, and I went to make him a cocktail, and I don't even remember what it was anymore. But when I presented it to him, I told him that, you know, he was obviously in a little bit of a mood, so I made it strong and boozy. And he was bitter on the outside, but a sweet romantic underneath. And when he tasted it, he said, "I didn't even know it when I sat down, but this is exactly what I want right now." Sometimes listening has nothing to do with the exact words that are coming out of someone's mouth, but the actions and emotions that they're sharing with you. Be mindful of those. I'm not an expert on anything, but I know enough about enough to be trouble. I give you the gift of tending to the people in your lives. Listen to their words, see their actions, sense their emotions. Feed their souls and their livers with drinks foraged from this very ground. Appreciate what you have and toast to it. Seriously, is anyone else ready for a cocktail? Thank you. Cheers.